Well, good morning and welcome to worship. Here at First United Methodist Church of Waxahachie, we welcome you, all of you here in the sanctuary with us and all of you online, our members and those of you who are our guests too. Some of our guests we haven't even met before, but we're so happy that everyone's tuned in and come and we're all together. I wanted to thank everyone for the wonderful response we've had for our Operation First Day of School. And if you don't know what that is, I think most of the Waxahachie folks know. It's an event that our school district puts together so that children in need have those school supplies the first day of school. So they ask churches and community partners to gather those supplies, and then they have an event, which this year it's going to be August 1st, where those families in need can come and gather those supplies for their students. So they'll have them that first day. We were asked to collect 1,000 bottles of 4-ounce glues. It was a sticky situation, but we pulled it off as we always do. And we had a big drive-through event last Wednesday that many of you participated in. And last count, we had 1,498 bottles. Yay! And I thank you all. What a blessing you are. And I know that this will help a lot of kids. If you've already purchased bottles and you just didn't bring it last Wednesday, that's okay. Bring it on and we'll make sure it gets to the school district. I also want to remind everyone that the church is here. It's here for everyone, all the members and all the guests. And if during this time of pandemic that you feel God is calling you in some way to step forward in your spiritual life, I hope you'll call us. If you've not been baptized, we can make that happen. We've had a beautiful baptism here on a weekday. If you haven't joined the church, but maybe you've been visiting for a while, we hope that you know that we're here to do that for you. If you need to talk to a pastor, the pastors are here. We hope you'll take advantage of that time. We just want to encourage you that even though we can't meet in our small groups and do things that maybe we've always done, we're still here. And we want you to know that we're here for you and the church is here. So now, let us just prepare our hearts and minds for worship on this hot and beautiful Sunday morning.
Thank you. We are called together this day to praise God, and we rejoice in the knowledge that God welcomes us. We are called together to listen for God's voice and guidance. Open our hearts, Lord, to receive your words and will. In the coming moments and days, let's let God lead, that we may experience the blessings of God, our Redeemer and Healer. Thank you. Please be seated, and let's continue in prayer together. Oh God, our Helper, there are times when we can really relate to Jesus' disciples when they asked him, "Would you please teach us how to pray?" We've heard prayers and we've read prayers, and some of us have been praying ever since we were young children. But there are times we hardly know where to begin or what to say. Shall we start with the pandemic that is affecting our world? Oh Lord, we pray for those who are working on vaccines, and we pray in a special way for those who work on the front lines of healthcare. But we also pray for wisdom and guidance from you in terms of how we conduct our own lives, since the matter of how we slowed the spread of this disease has become a point of debate, even anger between people. Yes, Lord, teach us how to pray. Help us to hear from you about what ought to guide our thinking and behavior. The scriptures make it so plain that we should regard the needs of others and even think of others more highly than ourselves. Maybe what we ought to be praying is that you'd help us live by what we claim to believe. Should we pray about economic matters, about people losing their jobs and insurance and who fear loss of income? Jesus said there are always going to be poor people in our midst, and we understand that to be true, but we don't want it to happen, especially in our nation or our community, in our family, in our circle of friends. We know that there are forces at work which we cannot control, but we also know that you invite us to help and care for those in need. So help us know how to pray and to recognize that there are things we can do, especially in terms of our response to the needs of our neighbors. None of us can do everything, but all of us can do something. Jesus taught that we should pray that your kingdom would come on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us, O God, for the times that we have resisted that kingdom's coming, both on a social level or on a personal level. We're going through a time of big cultural shifts, social changes. We feel and read stories about the upheaval, the unrest. Oh God, give to us wisdom to discern what your will is, and then help us become willing to not only allow your kingdom to come among us, but to welcome its coming. At this time of year, and in this set of circumstances, we pray in a special way for children, parents, school administrators, health care workers, government officials, lawmakers, that they too would be granted wisdom and courage. We pray for those who worry over the future, who need hope and strength in the present. We trust you to forgive us our ignorance and our arrogance. Keep working on us, Lord, and since you've forgiven us so many times, help us forgive one another. Help us that we would continue to let you guide both our praying and our acting. We pray all these things, having been guided and taught by Jesus, whom you sent to be our teacher, brother, and Savior. And so it is that we join in praying the prayer that he taught his disciples and teaches us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Gracious God, my heart renew. Make my spirit right and true. Cast me not away from thee. Let thy spirit dwell in me. Thy salvation's joy impart, steadfast make my willing heart. Our hymn of preparation this morning is Take Time to Be Holy. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4. I invite you to please stand if you are able as we sing together.
For the reading of God's Word. The scripture readings for today are located in the Gospel and Hebrew scriptures. The first reading is found in the 6th chapter of Matthew, verses 1 through 7, and the second reading is in Psalms 51, verse 6. Matthew 6, verses 1 through 7. Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them, for then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give alms, do not sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do, in the synagogues and at the streets, so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door, and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you are praying, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Psalms 51, verse 6. You desire truth in the inward being, Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart. May God bless the reading and hearing of these words. Thanks be to God. You may be seated.
Thank you, Natalie. I'm not meaning to embarrass you, but I got to tell you folks something. She came up and, of course, was reading off of her smartphone, but what you did not see is what I noticed over her shoulder. While she was waiting to come to her place, her phone had gone back to its opening screen, and she had to put her password in, and she messed up a couple of times. And I thought, we're going to be stuck here because the kid can't remember her own password. But you did great. Today I'm preaching the next in this series of sermons on the classic disciplines of spiritual growth. Now, just in case someone, and I can imagine someone fairly asking, I don't know if we should be taking all this sermon time to talk about these sorts of things. I can understand maybe doing this in a group setting, a small group, a Sunday school class, maybe having a Wednesday night course on this sort of thing, but I think sermons ought to be about Jesus and sin. Well, I can understand. I understand. Let me remind us all, myself included, that Jesus spoke repeatedly about the importance of growth. He used all these agricultural metaphors to describe what it was like to be a part, to become a part, and then continue as a part of the kingdom of God. He talked about how being part of the kingdom of God was not just a one-time moment of faith, but a life and a lifestyle, growing, becoming more faithful as his follower. And as regards the sin part, let's remember that it's through practicing these time-tested ways by which we grow that we are made wiser in avoiding sin and stronger in resisting sin. So, I think the topics are relevant and important for anybody that wants to become, and continue as a follower of Jesus. Now, if you've been following along in this series, whether here in the sanctuary or online, then chances are you haven't been too surprised by the topics we have covered. Whether or not one actually practices or engages in these disciplines, you've at least heard of them. We talked about prayer, and we talked about silence and solitude. We talked about fasting. And last Sunday, we talked about observing the Sabbath. But this morning, we come to one that seems out of place on such a list. Today, we consider the spiritual discipline of secrecy. Secrecy? What does secrecy have to do with being a Christian or growing spiritually? If you've done any reading in the area of family dynamics or in addiction studies, then you know that secrets are not always good, and in fact, keeping secrets is bad. Alcoholics Anonymous has a slogan that says, "You're only as sick as your secrets." In these cases, secrecy is related to shame. It's about dysfunctional, personal, interpersonal, family dynamics used to manipulate others, embarrass, shame others. It's about having secretive ways of living which help us deny or ignore the problems in our lives. People keep secrets in these circumstances so that they don't have to deal with the pain of facing them or acknowledging their effects. Here's something we know, and you ought to know it too. Domestic violence, incest, child molestation, alcoholism, drug abuse, These things that we think of as highly embarrassing, shameful, are among the secrets that are kept going by secrecy. Sometimes they are kept going from one generation to the other. In these cases, secrecy is part of the problem. In these situations, it's revealing the secret. Someone daring to reveal the secret that is so very important. When they do, it's like lancing the boil of infection on one's body. It's like daring to expose the wound so that it might be treated and receive medication. So, I don't want us to be confused as I begin this sermon when I talk about secrecy. Secrecy can sometimes be very harmful. However, when we talk about the spiritual discipline of secrecy, we're talking about something very positive, something that helps us grow, something that helps us become stronger, to live more faithfully as children of God and as followers of Jesus. In a nutshell, spiritual secrecy is about paying attention to the interior, sometimes very hidden, secret parts of our lives. It's about engaging in a long-term adventure of exploring where it is we've come from, what it is we think, how it is that we feel. And it's about understanding the very important difference between exterior, visible things and the interior condition of our souls. As I said, this is really a good thing. It's also a daring thing, and it's very much an adventure. A moment ago, we heard Jesus teaching about how to pray and how to not pray. Natalie read for us words that for many of you are familiar about Jesus saying, look, when you pray, don't do it for the sake of those who are watching. Don't do it in a way in which you are concentrating on showing off. Same thing with giving, same thing with sharing. It's interesting to interpret this. Jesus says in this teaching that if you do it for these reasons, these showing off reasons, you won't have any reward from God. Now, one way to perhaps interpret that is by thinking, okay, God sees the interior motives of our souls, and maybe God hears this prayer, but God knows why we're doing it, so God hears the prayer and decides, nope, I'm not doing it. That's one way of interpreting this transaction. I think it means something else. I think Jesus is saying, if you're focused over here, you're talking about something that really doesn't have much to do with God. It's about other people. It's about your ego. It's about showing off and making sure that you look good. But that's not very much, that doesn't have very much to do about with God. It's over here, the motives, the reasons. What's going on inside? Now, you lay that stuff bare before God. God can work with that because that's about what it's supposed to be about. Praying is supposed to be about a relationship with God, not what other people think about that relationship. Giving, sharing, it's supposed to be about feeling care and compassion and concern for others. Not about writing a check or giving a big bunch of cash and then making sure that others see it. That's about a different thing. That's about getting publicity, or maybe it's about encouraging others to give, whatever it is. God works over here on this stuff. There's a church I know that for some reason, I don't know all about its history, but for some reason through the years had developed a tradition of putting a plaque on almost anything that was purchased for, given to, or donated by someone to the church. I was in this church once. And as I walked through the halls, I noticed it. It was obvious. Music stands, pictures, chairs, lamps, plaques on doors. Did I mention the water fountains? Plaques on water fountains. Now, this pastor, the pastor of this church, or at least someone who had been pastor for, gosh, I think 10, 12 years, was a friend of mine. And so I stayed in touch with her, and she told me about how things were going. They were going well. She's a good leader, great preacher, and some more people started coming to the church, and they got some money together, and they said, we're going to add a wing onto the building, and they did, and it went swimmingly. Everything was fine. They were going to add educational space because the number of small groups in their church was continuing to grow. The trustees decided, let's hit reset on this plaque thing. In the new wing, we're going to make it so that there's no plaques, because it had become something of a hassle to them as well. If a plaque fell off of a music stand or a microphone or something, they had to do this research and replace it, and they were worried about people getting their feelings hurt. And so that, now, the way this often goes in a church is that when there's a building program, you vote, and hopefully it's not a 50-50 thing. Don't go ahead with the building project if it's 51-49. There's about 80, 90, maybe 95% of the people say, yeah, let's do this. And there's a real esprit de corps, and everybody tends to get on board to greater or lesser degree. Folks give sometimes sacrificially, but when the building starts going up, it's exciting. And then people say, you know, I've given this, but what are we going to do for furnishings? And let's make sure that this looks good. We're so excited about that. And out of that sort of attitude, a woman came to the pastor and said, we would like to give all the tables for the children's educational area. We know they're going to need the furnishings here. We'll give all the tables. And so she wrote a check that day, gave it to the pastor, which was gratefully received. Now, I don't know if it was before or after the tables were actually purchased, but she found out that there weren't going to be plaques on the new tables. And she came back to the pastor and said, I want our money back. Whenever a person gives, that's good, and it accomplishes good. But we should be aware that God is really more interested in what's going on inside. God just doesn't want buildings and gifts and money. God wants people that are caring and generous and want to be a part of the work of God. The gift is one time. The quality and the character that is in one's soul, that's ongoing. Spiritual secrecy is about paying attention to those parts of ourselves, examining the whys and the hows of the good we do. And examining those things helps us grow in those ways. Another important benefit of the spiritual discipline of secrecy is the way it helps us look deeper into ourselves than we typically do. Interesting thing, most people I know are busy. Even old, sort of more or less homebound, more or less retired folks, they're still busy. Most everybody finds something to keep themselves occupied, whether it's watching television or thinking about the next thing that they're going to do, or cooking dinner or planning to cook dinner, that sort of thing. And that's where most of us live our lives, in terms of thinking, what do I need to do next? That's good to plan, but it's true that we don't often enough, I think, take time to say, okay, that's the visible stuff. Dinner, the recipe, the chores I have to do, the places I'm going to go, that's one level of my life. How's the other part of my life going? Some years ago, my wife Georgia and I were parenting group facilitators in a program that sought to help teach parenting skills to a group of parents who had had their kids taken away from them because of abuse or neglect through the court system. But they really did love their kids, and they really did want them back, and they were willing to learn, and they were willing to do new things so that they could once again be a family. And Georgia and I were group facilitators. One of the most important things that this court ordered program sought to convey was to teach these parents to monitor themselves, to figure out how it is they're feeling, to figure out when their stress level began to rise, because it's at those moments the parents lose it. It's at those moments that the parent, overwhelmed with the fact that she or he is trying to cook dinner and you got these four kids all yelling at you, it's these feelings that are down below the surface that may be there because of lack of money or not having groceries in the house or whatever it is that cause people to lash out. So one of the most important things that this court sought to teach these parents was pay attention to what's going on in you. And that's what psychotherapy does. A good therapist, when you go in to see a therapist who can provide healing over time, they don't put into your consciousness things they want you to know and believe. That's not how it works. They use words and phrases and very gently try and draw out from you and me what's already there. We may or may not be aware of it. It may have been hidden away for a long time. But can you lift it up in such a way that you actually see it? That's what the discipline of spiritual secrecy is about. Can you imagine going to a party, and we like to go parties, and we're having a good time, when all of a sudden we spot somebody at that party that we do not care for? Now, hopefully, as they approach, we can summon the courtesy and the manners to treat them well. We sort of, are polite. We're not rude to them. When we invite God into our lives, it may just, in terms of spiritual secrecy, it may just be that following that encounter, and it goes well. We didn't punch her in the face. We didn't say the thing that we wanted to say. So good for you. But we may sense ourselves in the coming days being led by God's Holy Spirit to ask a few questions. Why don't you like her? What is it you've got against her? Are you jealous? Are you envious? Are you resentful? Did she do something one time that you haven't forgiven her for? See, when we allow God to work at that level, we're allowing God to take care of what's causing the turmoil. The real issues get taken care of by allowing God to deal with that invisible part of us. Every now and then, there are those stories in the news that embarrass me. My guess is they embarrass you too as part of the church. If you're watching and you consider yourself a Christian, then I imagine you are embarrassed too. When we read about these persons who were presented as upright, moral leaders, sometimes famously so, and then we find out something about them, something from their past, maybe something from the recent past, which causes them to be publicly shamed. I'm especially sensitive, I know, to those who are pastors or other religious leaders. People admire them. They follow them. They put their faith in them. In some cases, they have done wonderful work in terms of building a church, amassing a large congregation, doing good in the world. And then we find out they had this extramarital affair, or they embezzled this money, they did this thing, and we are sad, and I'm always sorry when that happens. First of all, because it's let down so many of their followers. Second, it provides fodder for those who are always looking to throw darts or shoot arrows at Christians in general. We hear a lot of online chatter about, see, all Christians are hypocrites. I especially think of the children. I especially think of the children and youth who put their trust in this person and have been let down. But these are such good examples, I think. I take note of them. I cut them out. I've got a file of them that I remind myself about. It goes back 20, 30 years. Because it reminds me how important it is to be strong and solid in the secret parts of our lives. Not just the visible public areas. In fact, those who get the most attention are newsworthy precisely because they looked good on the outside. Things were going well. Their church was growing. They had all these TV followers. And I always find myself thinking, that person must have been going through hell. The reason I think that is because in most cases, these are not bad people. They started well. Their calling was real. Their response was sincere. They just forgot to take care of those secret areas of their lives. And I think it must have been hell for them these last few months or years. Living this double life, walking around in fear of being caught, feeling ashamed before God for their hypocrisy, it's sad. The practice of spiritual secrecy reminds us of where our real strength comes from. It's like a tree. In order to have a tall, strong tree, you've got to have deep, solid roots. You don't see them, but they are so important. We see and admire exterior results, but those results are often the result of, those are often the visible evidence of health and vitality at a deeper spiritual level. And I just got to ask you, not in an accusing way, but I invite you to ask yourself this question: what's going on in the secret places in your life? Have you found the time you need for prayer? And in your prayers, is it just a bunch of talking, or are you occasionally listening? Have you developed some habits such as writing some things down? Have you dared to unearth some things from your past or from deep within your spirit that you know probably shouldn't be there, but because you trust God, you're willing to dig them up and ask God to help you look at them? Jesus told a parable about a person whose life was like a house. And some storms came. The storms came and the winds blew, it says. And the house fell down. Why? Poor foundation, Jesus said. Not the visible stuff. That which is often ignored. The stuff that's underground. There are other people, he said, who, when the storms come, are able to withstand that. What's the difference? Oh, it's the foundation. It's the invisible stuff. It's the part that is down deep underneath. The last idea that I want to share with you this morning about the spiritual discipline of secrecy is that as we allow God into the secret areas of our lives, our relationship with God deepens. We share these experiences with God. Not every moment is a victory. Sometimes it's a day or a week or a month or a year or a decade during which God is working on us. But as we share that part of our lives with God, what happens becomes a pivotal moment and precious memories. It's like an old married couple that has been through a lot together. They love each other for things that you cannot imagine. They've had so many little things that have challenged them, but they were times during which they didn't turn on each other. Or a best friend who knows all about us and still loves us. We've experienced these things, we've shared these things with God, and God over time becomes our friend. Here's something I believe is probably true about every one of us here and probably everyone who is watching online. You have a secret. It's a problem, it's a weakness, it's an addiction. Perhaps it's something that you did maybe years ago. It's so embarrassing. It's so shameful that we hope no one ever finds out. But we know that God knows. And we believe that God has forgiven us. There may be a decision that you almost made. I know this is the case in my life. Something that I almost did, felt led to do, could have done. But I feel like God steered me away from that decision. And I can't prove that God saved me from something. You can never prove what doesn't happen. But I think that happened. And I believe that happened. It's kind of a little secret that God and I share. There's a juicy piece of gossip floating around. We heard about someone. But then we decide, it's going to end with me. I'm not going to repeat it. And no one will ever know. You won't get credit for this publicly. And no one will know what you went through, which led you to that decision, except, of course, for God. And you. But isn't that who matters most? Let's pray together. Thank you, O God, for the way that you continue to work on us. Thank you for the way that you deal with those things which are so private and secretive, in some cases so scary and fearful that we dare not look at them, but we sense your Spirit leading us, gently prodding us to maybe take a look, maybe trust you to help us gain perspective, maybe understanding where these things come from, so that after a while we sense ourselves not only helped, but maybe even healed. Grant that it may be so, O Lord, as we open ourselves, heart, mind, spirit, soul, memory and history to thee. We pray through Christ our Savior. Amen.
Good to me.
Thank you, Alan and Amy. Here's one thing that I think is indisputable. You can't beat God to the punch in terms of giving. Our world is made better. Our souls are made better. Our lives, our communities are made better. Whenever we give and contribute to something as important as the work that the church does. But we don't give in order to get that feeling. In other words, we don't give and then get a blessing. Rather, we give because we've already been blessed. We've been given life, hope, faith, and the means to join God in Jesus' continued work in the world. So, during this time of the pandemic, we don't pass offering plates, but you can spend this time as we have our offertory to pray for the faithful stewardship of every dollar that is given to this church as we seek to do what God wants us to do. Those of you at home, if the Spirit so leads you, you may use this opportunity to join us in the text to give option, or maybe write a check, or maybe just pray for us here and the work that we are a part of. Let's pray together. In gratitude and hope, we give to you, O Lord. And may this just be one more way in which we allow you to work in us and among us and through us. We rejoice in the opportunity. Through Christ our Savior, we pray. Amen. Thank you.
This morning's hymn of invitation is When We Are Living. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4. Please remain standing.
As we leave this place, what is our mission? To grow in the knowledge, service, and love of God as we share Christ, disciple believers, and serve others. As we prepare to go out this week, may the God of hope, the God of second chances, the God of the resurrection bless you with strength and courage today and all your days. Go in grace and peace. Amen.